Good evening. It's 6:05 now. I think we'll get started. So welcome to today's Kenya Society of Anesthesiologists hosted weekly webinar. Our faithful audience and all of you who are tuning in for the first time, thank you for joining us. We at the KSA are constantly honored to host you, our ever-expanding family, which draws from not just the anesthesia fraternity, but various other allied specialties and cadres. You'll hear me say this every week. It is because of and for you that we congregate. Our invited speaker, Dr. Nabukwangwa Simiyu, thank you for gracing us with your time and effort for today's presentation. I'll introduce her in detail in a bit. Our panelists, Dr. Wilson Nganga and Dr. Anthony Kamau, thank you for sharing the floor with Dr. Simiyu. The executive committee of the KSA for staying on top of organizing this series. Our sponsors today, Fresenius Kabi, for supporting this exchange of knowledge. The KSA and all her members and partners, not the least of whom includes the Critical Care Society of Kenya. Ms. Shelmith Macharia, our society administrator, apologies, thank you. I am Angela Ongewe, and I will be moderating this session. I ask that we, as usual, keep our microphones muted and our videos off for the duration of the webinar. Welcome you to write your questions in the chat box and we'll address them during the panel discussion, which we'll combine with the Q&A session. So let's jump right to it. We'd like to welcome Dr. Nabukwangwa Simiyu. I met Dr. Simiyu, I think a little over a decade ago. She's one of those people who was never young and foolish. She still bears her refreshing sense of humor and serves as a consultant anesthesiologist at the Kisii Level 5 Hospital. She has a special interest in pediatric regional anesthesia. And today she will take us through today's topics, which is ultrasound-guided subclavian perivascular brachial plexus block. Welcome, Dr. Simiyu.
Thank you so much, Dr. Angela.
Welcome.
I'm just trying to share my screen. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, it looks good. We can see it.
Okay. Are you sure the introduction was mine?
Very much so yours, Nabukwangwa. Very much so. Karibu.
Okay. Welcome, everyone. Today, we are going to talk about subclavian perivascular brachial plexus block. Am I audible? Angela?
Yes, you are. Sorry, you are.
Okay. So some of the objectives that you're going to go through are the definition and history, anatomy of the brachial plexus, importance of ultrasound-guided subclavian perivascular brachial plexus block, indications and contraindications, preparation and complications. So to start us off, we would like to look at subclavian perivascular brachial plexus as in the origin of it. The technique was introduced by Winnie and Collins in 1964. And the concept was based on the anatomical concept whereby we all know that the neurovascular bundle is surrounded by a fibrous sheath. So for you to perform this block, you have to go through the fibrous sheath. You have to pierce it, of course, with a needle, and you have to deposit your local anesthesia agent close to the nerves. And actually it has an advantage in that the fibrous sheath will limit the diffusion of the local anesthesia agent away from the nerves. So it gives it actually a longer time to stay, to be near the local anesthetic agent. So a bit of history of the subclavian perivascular block. It's referred to as the spinal of the upper limb because this is the only practical alternative to general anesthesia for surgery of the upper limb. We've had evolutions of the approaches to this block. And the first block actually was performed in 1884 by a surgeon by the name William. And what he did was that he exposed the brachial plexus and blocked it directly with cocaine. 10 years later is when we had an anesthetist by the name Dietrich, who performed the first percutaneous supraclavicular block. and he used the anatomical landmarks whereby he hit the needle. He hit the first rib with a needle and he was directing it towards the T2 and T3 spinous processes. The only disadvantage with this approach is that we had higher rates of pneumothorax. And over time, we've had a modification of the method by Winnie and his group by use of peripheral nerve stimulation. In 1978, we had ultrasound-guided peripheral nerve block by Lagrange. And actually what he did, he just identified the subclavian artery and posterolateral to it is where he found the brachial plexus and he was able to block it. And in the recent past, I think we are going to lose our jobs as anesthetists because now we have robots that have come in. And actually we are having robot-assisted blockade of the peripheral nerves. So why the brachial plexus block under ultrasound guidance and not the use of the peripheral nerve stimulation as what you used to do before? So first and foremost, we need to look at the regional anesthesia, the peripheral nerve block. What are the advantages over the general anesthesia when you're going in to do surgery of the upper limbs? It's easy and faster to perform when you compare the blockade of the peripheral nerve and the general anesthesia. And you're going to avoid the complications of GA, for example, difficult intubation, the post-operative nausea and vomiting, and other complications that are associated with GA. In patients who have comorbidities, for example, severe cardiac diseases and severe respiratory issues, you want to choose a technique, anesthetic technique that is safer to the patient. And in this case, the brachial plexus block is much preferred compared to the over GA. This is the best technique of anesthesia when you're talking about ambulatory surgeries because these are the patients you want them to go home on the same day. You want them to have early mobilization, and actually it has been confirmed that it improves surgical outcomes and improves rehabilitation. Now, when you have a patient who has a frozen elbow, these are patients who are going in for a procedure, and after that they'll have like very many manipulative procedures and physiotherapy at the elbow region. And these are the best patients that you want to leave in a catheter for continuous delivery of local anesthetic agent to offer analgesia during those manipulations. When you look at the cost, when it comes to peripheral nerve blockade, when you look at the cost in terms of the hospital and the patient, it's much cheaper compared to GA because these are patients who will come in, will have the block, recovery from PACU and discharge to the ward is much faster, discharge from the ward to home is much faster. And then look at the human resource and other resources used when you're doing your peripheral nerve block compared to the GA, it's much cheaper than GA. A bit of anatomy, because when you're going to do your sonoanatomy, you must have knowledge of surface anatomy of brachial plexus. It's a very superficial brachial plexus, very superficial, about 3 to 5 centimeters from the skin, and it originates from ventral rami of C5 to T5. Although we have anatomical variations and you can have prefix or postfix brachial plexus. When you talk of prefix brachial plexus, you have a very big C4 and a very minimal T1, but no T2. When you talk of postfix brachial plexus, you have either no C5 ventral rami or a very minimal ventral C5 ventral rami, and you have dominant T1 and dominant T2. So brachial plexus innervates the whole of the upper limb except the medial part of the upper arm, where it gets its innervation from T2. And as you can see on my left, you have the roots, the ventral rami C5 to C8. The C5 and C6 will join to form an upper trunk. C6 will continue as a middle trunk, and C8 and T1 will join to form the inferior trunk. These trunks will run in between two muscles, the middle scalene and the anterior scalene, before they divide into anterior and posterior divisions. Then all the posterior divisions will unite to form the posterior cord, and you'll have the anterior division of the lower trunk continuing as a medial cord, and you have the anterior division of the upper and the middle trunk forming the lateral cord. And these cords are named in relation to the first part of the axillary artery. Now, when you look at the anatomy also, you'll realize that the brachial plexus lies posterior lateral to the subclavian artery, okay? And it runs over the first rib, but below the clavicle to the costal clavicular fossa as it causes outside to the axilla. So why do we perform our subclavian perivascular block in this region of the trunk? Is because this is the area where the brachial plexus occupy the smallest surface area, and it's very compact. So this is just a continuation of anatomy, and depending on where you're going to block, due to different anatomical variation, when you're doing your subclavian perivascular block, you can either block the distal part of the trunks or the proximal part of the division. Now, if you're going to block the distal part of the trunks, that means you're going to block the supraclavicular nerve. But if you're going to block the proximal parts of the divisions, that means you're going to spare supraclavicular nerve. And that means you have to look for other modes of analgesia or anesthesia for that part of the shoulder if you're going to do the surgery around there, okay? So you have your divisions, you have your cords, and you can see you have several nerves that come from the cords, and you have your terminal four nerves, the musculocutaneous nerve, the median nerve, the radial nerve, and the ulnar nerve. Anatomy, we have no choice. We have to know a bit of anatomy of the brachial plexus, because now this will help us know if actually you blocked the nerve that you want to block, or we haven't blocked it the correct way. So this is just a correlation between sonoanatomy and surface anatomy, okay? So on my right, we have the sonoanatomy. You can see this is the pleura and this is the first rib. The pleura and the first rib, as you can see, they are hyperechoic, that is white in color. Now, when you look at the subclavian artery, it is black in color, it's hypoechoic. Then you have your scalene medius muscle, then you have the scalene anterior muscle, then you have your bunch of grips. Now, these are the brachial plexus, okay? If you see three nodules that are hypoechoic, that is black in color, surrounded by hyperechoic rim, just know that you're blocking the brachial plexus at the truncal level. If you see like more than three nodules, just know that now that is beyond the trunks, you're blocking the proximal part of the division. Of their divisions. Sometimes within the brachial plexus, you can see the branches of a subclavian artery, the suprascapular artery and suprascapular vein, and also you can have transverse cervical artery. So you have to know the surface anatomy for you to correlate with sonoanatomy when you're using the ultrasound to do the peripheral nerve block. This is just a nerve supply and dermatomes of the upper limbs. As you can see, the medial part of the upper inner arm is innervated by T2. And if you're going to do your subclavian perivascular block, T2 will be spared unless you have the post-fixed brachial plexus. So for you to block this T2, in case you're going to put a tourniquet or maybe you have a surgery around there, then number one, you can either do it at a ultrasound guidance, or number two, you can just do a local infiltration from the upper border of the biceps to the lower border of the triceps along the anterior axillary line. And again, when you're going to test at the subclavian perivascular block, you're going to look at the terminal nerves, pin prick and cold sensation. These are the areas that you're going to test for the sensation function. For motor function, you're going to do different ranges of motion of the arm or the hand, depending on where the surgery will be. So why should you use an ultrasound to do the nerve blocks instead of the conventional way, the blind technique, the use of neurostimulation? An ultrasound is like an eye to the anesthetist, and you're able to see what you want to see. You're able to do what you want to do under direct vision. You are able to look at the brachial plexus. How small is the brachial plexus? Where is it the exact location? Is it small? Is it big? Do you have inceptation within the brachial plexus? Do you have the branches of the subclavian artery within the brachial plexus? And as you introduce your needle, you're able to see the needle, where it's going, and you're able to see the tip and the shaft. When you try injecting your local anesthetic agent, you're able to see the spread, and you'll be happy if it's fully soaked. And if it's not fully soaked, you can manipulate your needle and go on and inject your local anesthetic agent. Now, under ultrasound guidance peripheral nerve block, you are able to see the anatomical relations of other structures around the brachial plexus. You're talking about the pleura, you're talking about the subclavian artery, and also you're talking about the rib. You have to see all these structures before you start injecting your local anesthetic agent. Now, the other method of blocking the peripheral nerve blocks is the use of neurostimulation. But remember, before you give you inject your local anesthetic agent, you have to make sure that you've elicited some responses, that is the twitches and the contraction of certain group of muscles for you to give your local anesthetic agent. So you can imagine a patient comes in with maybe a fracture radio ulna, and you're trying to do your neurostimulation. You have to elicit a response. The patient is already in pain, and here you are, you're eliciting some responses. It's more painful and discomfort to the patient. So to avoid all this, we're going to use the ultrasound to try and locate the nerve. And again, you're going to have a rapid onset of the block, because you're seeing where you're depositing your local anesthetic agent. So these are two illustrations I would like you to keep at the back of your mind, and the few things that you just have to see when you place that probe on the patient. Number one is the subclavian artery. Number two is the rib. Number three is the pleura. And of course, what you want to block, the brachial plexus. On my right, we have a colored figure there. Yellow presents the trunks of the brachial plexus. Red presents the subclavian artery. We have the first rib in blue, and you have the pleura in green. Assuming that picture is still at the back of your mind, this is what you're supposed to see when you do your ultrasound, when you try to do your scan. We have the hypoechoic structures here, and this presents the brachial plexus. The hyperechoic represents the rib, and also we have the subclavian artery here, which is hypoechoic. Okay, then you have the needle. As you can see the whole of the shaft, and you can see the tip, the beauty of ultrasound. On my left, you can see you have the bunch here of the brachial plexus. You have your first rib, and you have your pleura, okay? As you go down from A, B, and C, when introducing your local anesthetic agent, you can see the bunches are spreading out to the periphery, and that is the centrifugal effect, displacement of the trunks and the divisions the brachial plexus. So when are you going to block? When are you supposed to block? It depends. Do you want to block for anesthesia? Do you want to block for analgesia? if it's for anesthesia, then you do your block, you go in for surgery. But the good thing is post-operatively, you're going to take care of the pain with the same block, depending on how long the surgery will be. Okay? If it's for analgesia, you can give a block for procedural, for example, a patient with frozen elbow, and you want to do manipulations around the elbow, you can do the block solely because of analgesia. And if you remember anatomy very well from mid-humerus distally, any trauma or any traumatic injury from mid-humerus distally, you can use this block to give analgesia or anesthesia. Contraindications, you have infection at the puncture site. Patient refusal, if you have inexperience in ultrasound use, you're not able to use ultrasound-guided block. Allergy to any local anesthetic agent. And cooperative patient. And also trauma around the supraclavicular region because this will distort your anatomy. Equipments that we are going to need for this block, we have ultrasound machine with high frequency linear transducer, 5 to 15 gigahertz. We have sterile sleeve and gel, standard nerve block tray, but make sure you have resuscitation drugs ready and you have intralipid immersion in case you have lust. Then 20 to 25 mils of local anesthetic agent, 50 to 8 millimeters, 23 gauge short bivalve needle, sterile gloves and opening injection monitoring system. If you have well and good, because this will actually tell you if you are intraneural or extraneural, or maybe you are in a muscle, and you must have a monitor because our patient should be monitored during the block. You have to make sure that you have an ECG, SpO2, you're able to monitor blood pressure. So the procedure itself, there's no difference between a patient who is undergoing a block and a patient who is undergoing GA. Preoperative assessment must be done and it has to be documented. Something that you have to keep in mind is these patients, you're going to block this, the nerves of this patient. So you have to do a thorough examination when it comes to CNS. You're going to examine the radial nerve, you examine the ulnar nerve, the median nerve. You have an injury to any of the nerves, actually you should not go ahead and block the brachial plexus. You have to take a consent, and in the consent you're going to explain to the patient what you're going to do, what is expected, what will happen, and also how to take care of the limb after the procedure. And you must mention the complications to the patient. You have to confirm the site of the block, make sure that you have everything that you need before you start the procedure. You must have an assistant position the patient, disinfect the area. You can have a pre-scan just to have a gist of how the sonar anatomy looks like. And you give your local anesthesia that is lignocaine, 1 to 2 mils of 2% at 1 centimeter. Don't go beyond 1 centimeter, because remember we said our brachial plexus is between 3 to 5 centimeters from the skin, depending on the amount of subcutaneous tissue that our patient has. Then after that, now you do your now real scan. As once you identify your brachial plexus, you do hydrolocalization after the pop, going through the fibrous sheath using either single or multiple needling technique under ultrasound guidance. Advance after every 1 to 2 millimeters, but before you advance, you have to make sure that you're able to visualize the tip and you're able to visualize the shaft. If you're not able to visualize, try to tilt or to rock the probe for you to visualize the needle. Always aspirate before injecting every 5 mils bolus of the local anesthetic agent and test if the block has taken or not before the surgeon can take over. So perioperative period, this is just a summary of what you're supposed to do preoperatively, intraoperatively, and postoperatively. Preoperatively, I think we've talked about most of the things, but you have to document the type of block, time that was done, drugs given, including the volume and the dosage, and you have to test the block. Intraoperatively, before the surgical incision, the block also has to be tested, both motor and sensory. You have to make sure that your patient is monitored the same way you monitor a patient under GIA, and WHO checklist a must, so that you can confirm the patient, confirm the site of the block. Sedation, if necessary, you can give to a patient, especially pediatric patients, because they're not cooperative, so you have to sedate them. But again, in adults, I don't think this corona area, there's someone who will be willing to sedate a patient, because you must supplement oxygen with nasal prongs. So you have to make sure that your patient is pain-free and very comfortable so that you don't need to give this patient sedation. You have to check on your patient every now and then to see if they're comfortable or they're feeling any pain, and be ready to convert to GA or repeat a block or give a rescue block in case you have a failed block. Postoperatively, make sure that your patient is pain-free even after the block wears off. Give him a number, a contact to call in case there's any issue or any questions that the patient has. And also inform the patient about the timing of the return of both sensory and motor function. Talk to the caretaker, talk to the patient himself, so that they can take care of that limb that is insensate. Post-operative review, you have to do a post-operative review so that you're looking at the complications. Are there any complications that occurred during or after the nerve blockade? And for example, if the patient has a pneumothorax, make sure that you inform the relevant authorities so that they can do something about the pneumothorax. Patient position, make sure the patient is comfortable and you're also comfortable. You can either do the block when the patient is lying supine or the patient is in a semi-sitting position. Make sure that the hands are either in an anatomical position, or you can tell the patient to put the hand on his tummy. So the aim is to make sure that you depress the clavicle and you're able to manipulate your needle and manipulate your probe by the supraclavicular fossa. The patient will face the opposite side of where you're going to put your block. And you have to stand on the side where you're putting the block, on the same side where you're putting the block. Ergonomics, very important. Make sure that the screen is opposite the limb where you're going to give the block. You are on the same side of the limb that you're going to give a block. Make sure that your eyes and the screen of the ultrasound are in a straight line, so that when you're going to do your needling technique, you can look directly to the screen as you give your local anesthetic agent and you do your needling technique. You can imagine you're trying to do your needling technique and you have to turn over your shoulder so that you look at the screen. So you have to make sure that you are facing the screen directly on the opposite side of where you're giving the block. Probe position, I'll talk about two approaches on how you're going to place your probe on the patient. Of course, it's around the supraclavicular area. So the first method is the parasurgical approach, whereby you have your linear probe, you put it perpendicular to the first rib, but posterior to the clavicle. So the needling technique will be out of plane needling technique. This gives you easy manipulation of the needle, but now you see that you'll have a very short travel distance and you'll cause less discomfort to the patient. The beauty of this is that you can actually align the needle pathway as you hydro dissect with local anesthetic agent. The second approach is the coronal oblique plane in supraclavicular fossa. And actually, how you're going to place your probe. You're placing it posterior to the clavicle at the supraclavicular fossa, but parallel to the clavicle. Okay, so the needling technique here will be in plane needling technique. You'll be able to see the shaft and you'll be able to see the tip of the needle. The only disadvantage is that the needle will have to take a very long pathway. The needling pathway will be very long and it's very uncomfortable to the patient. And the pleura is also very close to the plexus. So chances of causing pneumothorax are high. So you have to control the needle as you advance. So this is just a continuation of in-plane versus out-plane. As you can see, when you talk of in-plane, you're looking at the needle in the long axis. So you look, you're able to see the tip and you're able to see the shaft. But when you talk of out of plane, you're looking at the short axis of the needle and this is what you see, okay? So it doesn't matter whatever in plane or out plane that you're going to use, so long as you're able to deposit your local anesthetic agent within the fibrous sheath beside the brachial plexus. So these are the needles that you're going to use for ultrasound nerve blocks. We have, like in our scenarios, we use the hypodermic needle, 23 gauge, 50 millimeters long. And also we have the echogenic needles that actually reflect the sound waves. You're able, the visibility is much better compared to the other needles when you're doing your ultrasound-guided blocks. So for continuous catheter delivery, you're going to use catheters. You leave in there for maybe 2 or 3 days so that you have continuous delivery of local anesthetic agent for analgesia purposes. So this is the catheter and these are the pumps. So you connect the catheter to the pump and you set whatever amount of local anesthetic agent that you want to be delivered per hour. So you've positioned your patient, you've placed your probe, you've delivered your local anesthetic agent. What do I expect? Number one, you have to see all the anatomical relations. You're talking about the rib, you're talking about the pleura and the brachial plexus, the subclavian artery, okay? Then you have to see the spread of the local anesthetic agent. You have to see the whole length, the shaft of the needle and the tip of the needle, okay? And what do I want? I want a centrifugal displacement effect of the trunk or the divisions of the brachial plexus. And I have to be happy with the spread, uniform spread of the local anesthetic agent. So local anesthetic agent that we use, we have several of them. The safer ones have been introduced into the market, but you have to look at the maximum allowable dose of the agents used. The dosages, we have to know the dosages that of the local anesthetic agent that we are going to use. We have volume versus concentration. Remember, for the brachial plexus, the volume we say 20 to 25, but we must have a maximum allowable dose. So you have, if you have a maximum allowable dose, but the volume is below 20, it's allowed, it's okay for you to mix with normal saline so long as it's the volume that you have for the local anesthetic agent is within the allowable dose to make the volume that you want. For you to have a successful blockade, you have to make sure that more than 70% of the transmembrane channel population over 3 consecutive nodes of Ranvier are soaked within the local anesthetic agent. But with the advent of ultrasound guidance, nowadays, we are using more low volume compared to the neurostimulation technique where you could use up to 40 mils of local anesthetic agent because you're doing a blind technique of localizing the brachial plexus. But these are some of the local anesthetic agents that we use for the brachial plexus block with and without epinephrine. So epinephrine is used as an additive, an adjunct, an additive, the same thing, so that you prolong your duration of the block, both motor and duration. And as you can see, for example, bupivacaine, the duration is 360 to 720 hours, sorry, minutes. This is minutes without epinephrine, but with epinephrine is 8 hours. Okay. And lidocaine, we can see that duration is 120 minutes without epinephrine, but 240 minutes with epinephrine. So several adjuncts have been studied, and actually they've confirmed that they prolong the duration of blockade, both sensory and motor, and actually they also facilitate the rapid onset of the block. I have, here we have several studies that have been done. And for example, buprenorphine prolongs the motor blockade by 6 hours. For example, if you mix it with bupivacaine, the normal for bupivacaine alone, the duration is between 6 to 12 hours. But now when you're going to add buprenorphine, the duration will be six hours more compared to bupivacaine alone. But before you use any adjunct when you're doing your brachial plexus, make sure you've taken a history of this patient, any comorbidities, any other drugs that the patient is taking, because some of these adjuncts have side effects, systemic side effects. Pediatric group, are they small adults? No, of course they are not. They're a special group of patients, and you have to be very cautious when you're dealing with these patients during blockade of their brachial plexus. They do experience greater pain than adults. Myelination is incomplete till 8 to 12 years of age. The nociceptive pathways are the same as adults. And as you know, babies, it's very hard to convince them that I'm going to give you a little prick, so we have to sedate the patient. And the concentration that you use is a bit lower than adults because of the low dosages compared to adults. And when you're dosing, make sure your dose according to weight and not. So is it practical to give brachial plexus block in pediatrics? Yes, it is practicable. There was a study that was done by Amiri, and they were looking at the upper extremity surgery in younger children between 6 months to 6 years. Okay, and actually, it was found that it's safe and easy to perform under ultrasound guidance, but they needed sedation during the procedure. So for ultrasound, you can either do the ultrasound guided block with GA or with the sedation in pediatric group, but it's safe and easy to perform under ultrasound guidance. So one cannot be prepared for something while secretly believing it will not happen. When you're going to give your brachial plexus, think of the complications, and you have to be ready to deal with the complications. And when you look at the complications, look at the structures around the brachial plexus, look at the blood vessels. If you puncture it, you're going to have a hematoma formation, or you're going to have accidental intravascular injection of the local anesthetic agent. If you're going to have your systemic disposition, you're going to have your last. So you have to make sure that you're ready to deal with the complications if they happen. Although with the ultrasound guidance, complications are less compared to when you're blocking the nerve with the peripheral nerve stimulation. So other complications are Horner syndrome, hemidiaphragmatic paralysis, pneumothorax, neuritis, failed block. Do you have subclavian perivascular failed block? Yes, we do. And when do you say a block has failed? A block has failed if you've given your block, but after surgical incision, you have to give fentanyl 100 mics or more, or it's equivalent. Or you've given your block, but after surgical incision, you have to convert to general anesthesia. Or you've given your block, but after surgical incision, you have to give local anesthetic agent to the surgeon to do local infiltration. So the block can either be total failure, incomplete block, patchy block, or a block will wear off because the surgery took too long till the block wore off, or you can have your misdirected block. You gave your local anesthetic, but maybe you injected the anesthetic into the muscles, okay? So how do you manage failed block? Number one, you just convert to GA. Number two, you can repeat the block. Number three, you can give a rescue block. So this is just an example of a lady who was 35 years old working in a factory and had occupational accident. And that is the type of injury that was there. So this is a patient that they did constructive surgery. The surgery itself took 12 hours and the agent that was given was bupivacaine plus dexamethasone. The anesthesia effect wore off after 18 hours. So what are the recommendations? Regional anesthesia to be part of anesthesia curriculum, regular workshops for practical purposes, resumption of regional anesthesia workshop by KSA in the counties, and recommend of regional anesthesia drugs and non-pharmaceuticals to be done by KEMSA for the county hospitals. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Simiyu. Thank you. That was a beautiful presentation. It was concise and clear, entirely practical. And I'm certain our audience feels much more pumped and equipped to attempt and succeed at this. Yeah. The questions are coming in. Some are coming into my private chat, some on the open forum. I'll let you take some time, you and the panelists, just to go through them and think about them as we go to the next segment. So we just take a little shift here, a little breather. Let us welcome our partners for today's webinar. Our sponsors, Fresenius Kabi, Mr. Vusi Moyo. Let's welcome him. He's the marketing and sales manager for Africa. And today he'll be reminding and updating us about their products. I won't preempt too much. Welcome, Mr. Moyo. Are you online?
Good day. How are you, ma'am?
Very well, thank you. Thank you. The floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you for inviting me, and you know for allowing us to be part of this beautiful occasion. And in basically, when I was sitting and thinking how and what am I can I you know introduce to you today, I thought it would be best if I give you a general an overview of what Fresenius Kabi is. And what we actually do as the company, so that I can I can take you away from all the clinical clinical information that you have doctor has just shared, so that we can have more of a commercial and other information regarding the company. Can you see the presentation?
Yes, Mr. Moyo, we can see the presentation. Thank you. Okay.
So basically what Fresenius Kabi is actually a global healthcare company that specializes in life-saving medicines and technologies for infusion, transfusion, clinical nutrition. Our products are basically used to help to take care of critically and chronically ill patients, which is basically, most of the patients that you are dealing with. As Fresenius Kabi, what our purpose is, we are basically committed to putting essential medicines and technologies in the hands of people who help patients and finding the best answers to the challenges they face. So basically we are taking them, the medicines and putting them in your hands so that you can have, the best best medicines and technology to be able to help your patients. And basically we are driven by the philosophy of caring for life. What we as Fresenius Kabi are, who we basically are as Fresenius Kabi, we are a global company, a global healthcare company again that basically specializes in life-saving medicines and technologies for infusion, transfusion, and clinical nutrition. And what our purpose is, we are again looking at making sure that you as a healthcare professional do have the necessary equipment and medicines to make sure that you take care of your patients. And these are what our company values are. We're looking at quality in terms of the products that we supply, integrity in terms, basically meaning that we are trustworthy, collaboration, we work well with you as partners and anyone that is actually we will be handling and using our products. We are again allow our creativity in terms of us delivering solutions. We are passionate and committed to what we do, basically to make sure that we care about our customers, and most of all we are customer focused. Just looking at in general what this management structure looks like in at Fresenius Kabi, we have a president who is sitting in Germany, and the direct reports, who are basically his board of management, are all the regional presidents. So looking at the regional president for Europe, Lama and Africa, which is where we, as Fresenius South Africa belong. And we've got Asia Pacific, Northern America. We've got a president for pharmaceuticals and devices, transfusion and cell technologies, and the finance division. And also with that, we have the special reports that actually report directly into the CEO. Basically looking at HR, quality management, corporate communication, global and medical, clinical regulatory affairs. Looking at where Fresenius actually, fits, Fresenius Kabi fits in the whole scheme of things. We are actually a group of, a group of different or four different business entities. There is a Fresenius Medical Care, which basically deals specifically with people with kidney failure. And us as Fresenius Kabi, we deal with medicine and technologies for infusion, transfusion, and clinical nutrition. And we have a group that actually operates with hospitals. We have a group that deals only with private hospitals. And we have project managers basically helping different hospitals in setting up hospitals. Where we have been as Fresenius Kabi, how it started, it started in 1462 as a huge pharmaceutical in Frankfurt in Germany. And then what happened after that was in 1912, the founding member of Fresenius bought the company. And then they expanded into infusions solutions in 1955. In 62, that's when we introduced intralipid into the market. In 1971, we introduced our amino acid solutions into the market. In 79, that's when we ventured into SIP feeds, basically introducing the fresh bean range into the market. And in 1984, we started the outpatient concept. In 97, we launched our first propofol for short-acting general IV anesthetic agent. We introduced that into the market in 1997. In 1999, we acquired a business of Pharmacia and Upjohn, creating the brand Fresenius Kabi. 2008, we again acquired APP Pharmaceuticals, which basically, I introduced us into IV generic medicines. The company was based in America, and then that basically gave us a leeway into IV medicines. In 2012, we started with transfusion. We became a global leader in transfusion after we acquired Fenwall. And in 2017, we started, with the biosimilars. After we have acquired and grew in our R&D pipelines, focusing mainly on oncology and autoimmune diseases. How our workforce is actually, structured across the world. In 2008, we only, though just the Fresenius Kabi group, we only had 20,500 people worldwide. In 2018, we were sitting at 37,800, basically showing that, you know, we are growing and we are looking at different, you know, at different regions where we can share and get our products, you know, for people to, you know, for people to use. How we are basically, you know, distributed by region. Europe has about 38% of the 37,800. North America has 21%. Asia Pacific 27%, and Latin America and Africa, we are sitting at 14% of personnel. Basically, this basis shows you where Fresenius Kabi has, you know, sales and marketing organizations. Remember, the sales and marketing organization in Africa is actually run from South Africa, like, which is why there's only, you know, that it's only depicted in the southern part of Africa, because we are taking care of the whole of Africa. Where we have compounding sites is almost throughout the world, and again showing that we do have two compounding sites in South Africa, and the research and development is basically throughout the world. When it comes to our responsibilities, we are, as a healthcare company, goes beyond our business and operations. We are responsible and sustainable management integral part of our culture and business. Looking at what we do, we have, like I have mentioned, that, you know, we have different classes of, you know, of medicines and products that we actually supply. We supply clinical nutrition. In clinical nutrition, that's where we have, you know, the fruity bean, and looking at, you know, parenteral nutrition and enteral nutrition. That's what we are supplying. And in the clinical nutrition, that's where we have basically looking at parenteral nutrition. That's where we have the Kabi vents and the smooth Kabi vents. And then in the enteral nutrition, we have the fruity bean and the sapotan. These are basically used in a critical care setting. And when looking at the parenteral nutrition, we do, this is basically in South Africa, wherein we are able to do a compounding of all all-in-one parenteral nutrition. We are looking at expanding that into the rest of Africa. And looking at the parenteral nutrition, that's where we have a unique product called the smooth lipid. A smooth lipid is a unique four oil mixture containing fish oil, soybean, a medium chain triglycerides, and olive oil, including fish oil as well. This is a mainstay product that actually allows us to actually, you know, supply in one product. We are able to supply all the four different oils to the patient. And we have also the dipeptiven, which is a glutamine dipeptide supplement. Basically, is associated with a decreased cost in ICU patient. Basically, getting the patients to be to heal early than expected when in ICU setting. And in parenteral nutrition, we have what we call a three-chamber bag, wherein we've got the three, which is the Kabi vent peripheral, we've got the glucose, and we've got and the lipids, all in one bag, ready to be used by the patient, which is a ready-to-use bag. These are the ready-to-use bags. And we have also different, you know, lipids and vitamins, trace elements that we can supply in order to make sure that, you know, there is we offer a complete nutrition to the patients in the critical care area. In the enteral range, we have products that we can use for patients that are actually, you know, are not able to not to swallow. Which basically are the tube feeds, and those that are able to swallow, which are the sip feeds. So we basically are trying to, again, make sure that, you know, the patients do have complete nutrition when it's needed. And looking at the IV medicines, we have we supply medicines in the hypnotic agent group, the pain and fever treatment, for antibiotics and treatment of critical and medical conditions. And the applications area for emergency surgery, intensive care, and general wards. And the therapeutic areas are anesthesia and analgesia, anti-infectives, and critical care. When looking at the infusion therapy, that's where we assist when it comes to a blood volume replacement, especially when you are doing surgery. Then that's where the colloids are actually used in terms of ensuring that there is a sufficient blood volume when it comes to ensuring that patients do not lose a lot of blood. And when it comes to application devices, we have devices that actually assist in terms of when you are in a critical care setting. All you need to do is just to set a machine, and it will assist in terms of making sure that a correct dose is given to the patient. We have different devices, syringe drivers, enteral nutrition for Amica pumps for enteral nutrition, the softwares, and the monitoring devices that we can offer as well. And looking at transfusion and cell technologies, we also have different devices that we offer that will assist in making sure that at the end of the day, whenever you are treating your patient, you actually maximizing and you have a proper support structure. Our achievements is basically throughout the world we have been growing. And it's basically to say that throughout the world, looking at what we are offering as Africa, we are offering 10% of the global Fresenius Kabi income. And currently we are growing, we are gradually growing in terms of our overage. In South Africa, there are a lot of milestones that we went through. And recently, what we have managed to do is to launch the different products into the global portfolio in terms of looking at bringing in products into countries like Kenya, Eastern African countries like Uganda and Tanzania. And lastly, how our supply chain is basically structured is most of our products are manufactured in Freiburg, which is in Germany, and they are transported into Port Elizabeth and then moved to Joburg. And from there, they are moved to all the countries that we have partnership with, including Kenya, Ethiopia, Uganda, Tanzania, all the Eastern African countries. These are the countries that we are currently very active in and actively having distributors and partners. And just to basically say that, as Fresenius Kabi, we are always open for to new ideas. We are always open to forming a partnership, and we are always at the point where in we would like to make sure that at the end of the day we do care for life, which is basically the philosophy that we live by. And thank you for the time.
Thank you, Mr. Moyo. Thank you for your presentation. Your products are a household name for the majority of us, and your contribution to safe sedation, anesthesia, and critical care is far-reaching, and we look forward to working with you in our various spaces, and we thank you for your steadfast support. Thank you very much, Mr. Moyo. So, thank you. There's a lot of praise coming in for the presentation, Dr. Simiyu. I'll ask you to come back online. And as I welcome our panelists for the day who will take us through the Q&A session, maybe around 20 minutes. So Dr. Wilson Nganga, I know if you're there, truly one of the most present human beings I've met. He wears many hats. you recognize his voice as being a moderator for these webinars. And he's worked in the county for almost 4 years, currently based at the Kenyatta National Hospital. He's a fellowship in regional anesthesia and acute pain management, and he sits on the KSA Executive Committee. He coordinates and runs regional anesthesia workshops, and he did one in Machakos this year, and we hope he will continue to extend the reach and knowledge and skill in the field. And our second panelist, Dr. Anthony Kamau, I think he's becoming a frequent flyer in this space, sports junkie and violent movie enthusiast. But he serves as a consultant anesthesiologist and regional anesthesia specialist, an excellent trainer and mentor to many, and has a special interest in his direct field of training regional anesthesia, as well as medical education. Karibuni, are you online?
Yes, you're online.
Okay. Dr. Nganga, Dr. Kamau, sorry, I would ask that if our delegates could turn off their video. Just so that we have enough bandwidth to hold everyone else. So just ask if you can turn your videos off and keep your mics muted. Thank you. So we'll try and ride through the questions. I'll just throw them out wide open for any of the three of you to tackle. Frederick Igueta initially asked about intralipid emulsion, and if somebody could elaborate on that. I know, Mr. Moyo, that's one of your products. So I'll leave it open before I target.
Hi, Angie. I hope you can hear me.
I can hear you, Dr. Kamau. Thank you.
All right, great. So for the intralipid, which is the lipid emulsion, I used a trade name. So it's usually 20% lipid emulsion. I think the mechanism they have thought that works is that it offers a lipid sink, so helps create an environment for the bupivacaine or whatever local anesthetic agent to bind to, and subsequently after that reducing the concentration of the local anesthetic agent intravascularly, and hopefully that will make the rest of the local anesthetic try and diffuse towards the lipid sink from a higher to a lower concentration. There's many schools of thought, but currently I think you should do 1.5 mils per kg as a bolus first, and then after that run it over a minute. After that, do 15 mils per kg over an hour. But if you do not have return of spontaneous circulation, I think there are some schools of thought that allow you to repeat once or twice every 5 minutes. That means repeat the bolus of 1.5 mils per kg every 5 minutes. Now, does it have to be a particular brand? I think not, as long as you have a 20% emulsion. For those of you who work in critical care units, I guess you can use any of those preparations that you use for nutritional support. If it has a 20% concentration, you can use that as your lipid sink. Have I ever had to use it? Touch wood, I haven't. I hope I remember those doses though.
You're a lucky one. Thank you, Dr. Kamau. Maybe I'll direct this back to Dr. Simiyu. Dr. Zipora Gaduya was asking about blocks in children, which you spoke about, where you perform them when they're asleep. I think you touched on it, but maybe you can reiterate if there are any special nuances or any controversies about this block in children. Dr. Simiyu.
Thank you, Dr. Angelo. As I had alluded earlier, when you're doing a brachial plexus block in children, you have to sedate them, and you can either do sedation plus the brachial plexus block for the surgery, or you can do general anesthesia plus the brachial plexus block for the surgery, okay? But remember, children won't cooperate unless the elderly pediatric group, they can cooperate. So what you do, you can do the dual, you can use the dual method whereby you have your neurostimulation plus the ultrasound guidance.
Thank you. Dr. Nganga, let me send this to you just about your experience. I'll combine a couple of questions here. Hosea Kipto was asking sort of what concentrations and how do you perform your blocks? So what is your typical mixture that you would use for your blocks? What are you doing in your practice? I think that was Ali Chandani who was asking that question.
Okay, thank you for that question. Normally, what we do, Dr. Simiyu has sent a very nice chart with the dosages, the maximum dosages, basically to avoid the local anesthetic systemic toxicity. So basically for supraclavicular block, what I do is, like she mentioned, the total volume, you want a volume of around 25, some people say up to 30 mLs of your total volume of the local anesthetic. So a practical thing I do is, depending on the scenario, when I have all the time, bupivacaine is a notoriously slow local anesthetic in terms of taking maximum effect. It can take up to 45 minutes to take a total effect on the blockade. That is to cause total blockade, especially if you have not added any adjuvant. So to cut, because most of the time we don't have all that time, what I normally do is I mix my local anesthetic, lignocaine, usually we have the 2%, and the bupivacaine, we have 2%. And so I just basically estimate the patient's weight and avoid going beyond the, because I use, most of the time I use either dexmedetomidine as an adjuvant or a steroid dexamethasone as an adjuvant. I avoid going beyond 4 mg per kg for lidocaine or beyond 2 mg per kg for bupivacaine, the 2%. If I feel like I need a little bit more volume to allow maybe a wider spread, I can throw in maybe like 10 mL of normal saline into that mixture to achieve maybe a volume of 35, 40 mLs with the local anesthetic of maybe 25 to 30 mLs. So basically that. And for the adjuvant for Dexmed, like I use around 30 to 50 micrograms into that concoction. And then for dexamethasone, I use 4 milligrams into that concoction. For that, for a standard adult, basically using let's say a 70 kg adult, but the ideal of course would be to do the mg per kg if you have the weight. I hope I've answered adequately.
Yes, that is, we're writing short notes, that's quite clear. Someone is asking, do you mean bupivacaine 2% or 0.5%? Oh, I think you meant 2 milligrams per kilogram. Yeah. Yes, I think that's what you said. Yeah, that's what you said.
Another clarification is for anesthesia, we are using neat solution. So we're not diluting, unless maybe you're throwing in maybe a few mLs of water for injection or saline to increase the volume. But for anesthesia, we are using the neat, that is the 0.5. Mm-hmm. Bupivacaine and the 2% lidocaine. For analgesia, maybe post-op analgesia or labor analgesia or whatever, now you can dilute as low as you want, either 0.25 or for bupivacaine or 0.125. Depends on how hard you want to knock the pain or if you have other modes of analgesia. But for anesthesia, we are using neat solution. For analgesia, you can dilute as low as you want.
Okay, so let me, thank you, Dr. Nganga. Let me throw this out to whoever wants to catch it. Block failure. This is reminiscent of spinals and failed spinals, yeah? So I'll combine Jean-Marcel and Hosea Kipto's questions, which is on what are the reasons for block failure really? And when we repeat, how do we repeat? How long do we take to repeat? When do we say we failed? And what amount do we use? Especially with ultrasound. If you,
I think I'll take that, Dr. Angela.
Thank you.
When you talk of fail block, I think I gave three definitions of a failed brachial plexus block.
Yes.
And normally you say it's a failed block if I gave also a table showing the onset, how long will it take for the local anesthetic agent now to block the nerves, okay? And I said, when you're using ultrasound guidance block, the onset is faster compared to when you're using your conventional technique, whereby you are using the blind method, the use of neurostimulation, okay? So when you're using the ultrasound guidance, you have to make sure that you have proper technique of nerve localization, and that is why surface anatomy is very important and sonoanatomy is very important. You have to make sure that you're placing your needle properly, the correct way, and you're also injecting the local anesthetic agent properly. Once you observe these three things, you're not going to have any block failure. Number two, the drug that you're using, have you looked at the expiry date? Most of the time, we just take a vial, we break it, and we inject the local anesthetic agent. You have to look at the expiry date. Maybe you're using a drug that expired more than 4 years ago. Okay, you have to look at what you're using and the expiry date. Number three, you have to make sure that you have primed the extension tubing and the needle that you are using. Sometimes, especially if you get some of these non-pharmaceuticals from certain companies, I don't want to name names, you'll find that the needle is blocked or the extension catheter is blocked, okay? So as much as you're having your local anesthetic in the syringe, but when you try to inject, nothing actually comes out. So you have to prime it before you start doing your performing your block. The other thing is mutation of the sodium channels. Studies have been done and have shown that some patients have mutations in their sodium channels. And as much as you're going to give your block, they won't act on the sodium channels for the block to be produced.
Thank you, Dr. Simiyu. It's interesting, even as you share in my private chat, I still have questions coming in about the same. I think many of us maybe have been scarred or are just very nervous about a failed block. So thank you for going over that again.
Okay.
Thank you. So maybe Dr. Kamau, Dr. Timothy Mwiti was asking for a comment on combined use of ultrasound and nerve stimulation for safety. And then as you tackle that, maybe a comment on bilateral nerve blocks in quote unquote severe respiratory disease. This is vis-a-vis phrenic nerve blockade. So this question has been asked by a few people. Maybe you can tackle that, Dr. Kamau.
Thanks, Angela. So combined ultrasound guidance with nerve stimulation definitely does increase your safety profile, because your nerve stimulation will show you what perhaps in a bit of better light the distance from the neural tissue. So the closer you are, the lower you can go and still get stimulation of that particular nerve. So if you're very close to the nerve and you reduce the voltage of the peripheral nerve stimulator, you will see that you're still able to excite that nerve. So that in combination with seeing visually the nerve tip does increase. The reason for this is sometimes what we think we are seeing as the tip may be a bit of a cross section. You might still be seeing the shaft, because if by any chance the plane of the needle and the plane of the X-ray beam, sorry, the ultrasound beam are not in plane, or they're not parallel to each other, you might have a bit of disappearance of the tip, and hence now that's where your nerve stimulator would definitely increase your safety profile. More so, as Dr. Nabukwangwa said, in children, that would be really important, because you have a patient who's perhaps under general anesthesia and will not perceive paresthesias that may guide you in terms of how close you are to the nerve. About the bilateral phrenic nerve block, so that's a really good point. So usually when you do a supraclavicular block, a certain percentage, I think they mentioned up to 50% of the patients may get a phrenic nerve block. How significant is this in patients who have normal respiratory physiology? Not really. The studies, I think, talked about something like 30% reduction in the forced vital capacity in these patients. So they might not notice that they have a phrenic nerve blockade because they have so many accessory muscles that are still helping with the respiration. And also you have the contralateral side being normal. Now, if you do this bilaterally, of course, you increase the amount of the percentage of forced vital capacity that has been reduced. And then in addition to that, if you do have a patient with respiratory compromise of any kind, especially things like COPD, severe asthma, I would perhaps really proceed with caution. And especially if you're doing it bilaterally, it's ill advised in patients who have COPD. And those who don't have, even if you're doing it just one side, if you can find another way to do a block that does not block the phrenic nerve, like doing it further down, infraclavicular or axillary, that would be advice. I hope that helps, Angela.
I think it does. Thank you, Dr. Kamau. Dr. Nganga, we're running out of time. Let me ask you, in your practice, Dr. Nganga, we consider you a severe technocrat here. This question is recurring, and let me advocate for our audience. The rescue block and how there's four people asking here and one on the public chat. Again, about repeating a failed block. Have you had to repeat a block, and how did you dose it yourself, if you've had to?
Blocks, and especially when you're using you're not using an ultrasound, let's say you're using the nerve stimulator, they sometimes can let you down, just like a spinal or an epidural. And yes, once in a while, you have to resort to other ways of alleviating the pain. So a rescue block happens. Like now, we've talked about supraclavicular perivascular brachial plexus. So what we normally do is at this level, if the block is patchy or you really need to do something extra and you want to do it in form of a block, you can go lower. You can do, because you still, especially let's say now you're doing this block for let's say hand surgery or the forearm bones, you still are at liberty to do a top-up at let's say the infraclavicular area or axillary area, or even slightly lower down at the individual nerves, let's say median, radial, ulna, depending on where the site of your surgery is. So what you have to put into question is the dosages for the local anesthetics. So if you had not used the maximum dosages, then now you can use you can top up with the little dosages that you had been, the window you had left to top up to the maximum dose that you can give for these particular patient, depending on the weight. So that's one of the things you can do. Sometimes, just like we do for spinal, you can repeat at exactly for, let's say, this supra clavicular block. You can still repeat. Maybe your positioning was not the best, or your needle technique was maybe not optimal. And or if let's say you had used a nerve stimulator and now you have an ultrasound, you can still repeat the block at the same level, but optimize to give the injection as close to the nerve fascicles or the nerve trunks as possible, to just try and optimize. But the options are repeat at the same level, go a little bit lower. Like sedation, or worst case scenario, then just go GA. Yeah, that's as much I can say.
Thank you. Thank you. The audience seems to be appeased. Thank you for your response. Thank you. We have 5 minutes to closing. I don't know if there's any parting comments. The questions are, some of them are still coming in. For our delegates, our audience, you're welcome to send in more questions and we'll try and direct them and also email you any answers that are not covered by the presentation, which will be up on our website. But Dr. Simiyu, thank you so much. The feedback about your presentation is quite spectacular. Everybody seems to be unanimous that it's extremely practical and useful. Thank you very much, Dr. Simiyu. Dr. Kamau and Dr. Nganga, thank you for joining us. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your insights. We are quite happy that our delegates feel that this was an edifying experience. I will just begin closing now. Our sponsors, Fresenius Kabi, Mr. Moyo, thank you for working with us, not just in this event, in general. Your support is invaluable to us and in all these spaces. You, our esteemed delegates, we thank you for joining us. KSA Executive Committee for organizing and running this calendar, and KSA members, all of you who've joined us from actually across the continent. I want to give quite some appreciation to Ms. Shelmith Macharia, who puts in a lot of time and effort running one successful event after another. There's tremendous amount of planning and coordination, follow-up and follow-through that goes into this. And she has really taken a lead in infusing her personal touch for these presentations and these webinars, and we thank her. We want to remind you that we as KSA don't stand alone. The Critical Care Society of Kenya and KSA are conjoined. And please visit our website, anesthesiakenya.co.ke. You'll find volume 10 of the Kenya Journal of Anesthesia and Critical Care Medicine. It's out. You'll find information about an app where you can upload your manuscripts. We're asking that all of you, I'm sure, are sitting on some wonderful insights and experiences and information and knowledge. Let's share it with the world. We welcome you to share your preferences and suggestions as regards the subject matter that we tackle here. Your questions, your comments and criticisms and contributions are exactly what we're asking for. And we thank you for working with us. And I ask that you accept our standing invitation for our weekly webinar next Thursday, same time and same place. Good night, family.